Yeah, I'm one of those, I guess, either blessed or cursed human beings who, from the moment I was born, I never thought about being anything else. Never was conflicted, never wondered, you know, what should my major be, you know. Someone's life has a good deal to do with the content of your work, I think, if you're someone who has a political or a social conscience. When I was born, the President of the United States was Harry Truman. And when I was 15, JFK was assassinated. In 1968, RFK and Martin Luther King were assassinated. So those are, you know, kind of really important. That was an era of tremendous, you know, social and political change from the 50s to the 60s. By the time I was a young adult, the Vietnam War had begun. And it was the rise of political consciousness of Chicanos, you know, Mexican Americans in Los Angeles, you know, right on the heels of the civil rights movement, the African American civil rights movement. And so, you know, my whole world at that point, you know, as a young, you know, college student, revolved around these political issues. And since I wasn't, you know, an organizer, you know, by, you know, talent or by, you know, training, those of us who are artists, you know, we met one another, and the way that we contributed to furthering, you know, this cause that we believed in was to provide creative support, image support. It was like, it was kind of the, you know, our way of learning about PR and the power of a visual that images can make on a political social agenda. But by the time I got to graduate school, I bumped into Carlos Alvarez. There were like maybe five Chicano students in the entire school, and Carlos and I were in the same class, and we hit it off. We kind of pretty much birds of a feather, kind of very curious and you know, political and, you know, interested in being involved. And so he introduced me to the other guys in Los Four. Beto de la Rocha, who is the father of Zach de la Rocha of Rage Against the Machine. Carlos Almaraz, who unfortunately passed away much too young. He's been gone for 20 years now. He died in 1989. Frank Romero, who is still very much alive, Gilbert Lujan, who is also still with us, and me. I came on as the fifth member, and for the next 10 years, you know, I showed with them. And we had alternating people. You know, we believed we had. Carlos put us through our paces. He very strongly believed that we should educate our political opinions, and so we had Maoist study groups, and we studied Marx-Leninism, and you know, we worked for Cesar Chavez, and we did street painting, and I mean we paid those kinds of dues in terms of intellectual foundation, you know, the things that we taught ourselves and then practice. But I think what we did, Gilbert Lujan is certainly kind of the godfather of the idea. We wanted to reach into the cultural consciousness of you know, of our people, who had never been, you know, said, you know, you can do this, you can stand up, you can march, you can protest, you can make a difference, and pull out those images that they would respond to, very much the way artists from the Middle Ages or from the Renaissance and Western art, you know, when you see these images in cathedrals and churches, it's because people didn't read. And so they reached out for images that they, you know, would be able to tell stories about the Bible or the New Testament. I think our challenge was to come up with symbols and imagery that other Chicanos, Mexicanos would react to, and they would get the message. So the skeleton is, you know, from pre-Columbian art. The heart is something that you can see in every church in Mexico. The heart. The image of the heart, of the Virgin, all those things that are just an amazing kind of background of cultural, political, and historical meaning. They seemed natural to use. You know, murals was something that happened to me. You know, it doesn't happen to everybody. You know, you get a chance to do public art. And as much as I enjoyed it, that was not my passion. That's not why I did art. I didn't want to become a muralist. And that was the thing that I shared in common with Carlos, is that we had been, you know, we had been educated at Otis Art Institute, very Western Renaissance, you know, classical kind of training, and And I always saw myself as, you know, being a studio artist and doing, I love beautiful art. I mean, I love narrative art and I love figurative art. It's just what I personally respond to, and I hope that there would become a time in my career where I could concentrate on that. And after that time, you know, I felt like I'd paid my dues, that I could, you know, return to doing something that was more personal. And even though, you know, the stories that I like to tell, I think of myself as a storyteller, are still very much, you know, driven by political or social subject matter. It gives me the opportunity, because it's not a public piece, to tell the story in my own way. I would never put the work that I, you know, the way that I work now out in public on somebody's building. It's just not, it's not suitable. It's not, it's too, it's you know, the approach, I think, is, you know, is wrong for public art. It's not clear enough. My intent now is to draw people in. I love color. And I think I have a natural sense of composition. And I try to draw people into this scene for, you know, you only have about a second, I think, to catch someone's attention. And hopefully in that second they stop and they consider, you know, they see these beautiful forms and color, but then they begin to wonder about the scenario here. And I provide only part of the story. And if I've done my job right, the viewer is stopped long enough to consider what the rest of the story may be. And if I can do that, I think I've accomplished what I set out to do. That show was it was amazing. It was about a year in the making. I haven't had a solo show in a long time, so it's really exciting to be in this. It's a large space, about 1,700, 2,000 square foot gallery. And there's 43 original works, including an installation that was created especially for the museum. In the gallery, when you first enter the gallery, right across from the doors is this wall. And on the other side is the Weight of Silence series, which was actually inspired by a poem. And so on the back wall, there are like 18 heads on this aubergine colored wall. So you go from the stark white installation on one side to the heads, you know, these row of, they're almost like, you know, like mugshots, except that, you know, there's a prominent red hand across, you know, the face of each one of the women. This beautiful young friend of mine in Chicago, who's from Mexico, a fantastic face, a very Indian, beautiful, high cheekbones, she let me plaster her face. And so I did a series of masks from ones that are really not discernible, only that there must be a human, you know, face. The way we've lit it, there are these tremendous shadows that are thrown onto the white wall that are just behind the installation. And you see the barbed wire, which we also created. It wasn't barbed wire that was bought. And then there's a field of black lilies along the bottom of this fence with one white lily. Tzompatli is a wall that was located at the end of the sacred ball courts in pre-Columbian Mexico. New Scholarship thinks that it may be actually the winners who were sacrificed and placed on the wall. My point is that, you know, these young women have a lot in common with, you know, the sacrifice of these men in a metaphorical way. And so they're on the top of these poles that kind of form a metaphorical border between the United States and Mexico, where these, you know, murders have occurred. I was really, you know, very, very gratified, you know, when it all kind of came together, looked, you know, fantastic. So I think it's incumbent upon artists and writers and whoever else knows about this to keep this in the public eye. Three of the four or five series that I've been working on over the last few years that I feel really, you know, strongly about. One of them are the murders in Juarez, of women in Juarez. The other is about Mexico itself, the tremendous political and social problems in Mexico. Adam and Eve, it puzzles a lot of people. And the Luchadora series, which is a kind of a woman, you know, empowering women sort of thing. And I, like a lot of artists, I think, you know, I think in streams or a series of things, or there's an idea that needs to be worked out over several pieces of work. And so I, you know, that's what I've been doing, especially through 2010. I concentrated mostly on the series. Irony, you know, but I've been told, you know, by people who look at my work, the irony is that some of the message and some of the imagery is really very tough, is very challenging. The idea that I'm presenting, the woman with the barbed wire wrapped around their bodies. But there's something so beautiful at the same time, the color, the form, that, you know, you're more likely to stop and look and consider than if the whole thing was very violent and repellent and angry. You know, I sort of you know, trick people by saying, oh, beautiful. And then suddenly, oh my God, that's really, those flowers aren't flowers, they're really thorns, they're really, that's really blood. I think when people get hit over the head, and I have this argument with my 19-year-old daughter all the time, you know, you can't see a video game today that isn't about killing somebody and having people bloodied, you know, on the screen, and, you know, slasher movies and, you know, all these other crazy things. And I think you can give people a hard message, a very challenging message to think about, if you do it in such a way that, you know, you don't, I'm not worrying about offending people, but of just turning them off by saying, oh, this is just too hard to look at, this is too depressing. I think you can present a very challenging message, one that's thoughtful, and you want people to consider and hopefully, yeah, to even go out and, well, I want to know more about this. If you put it in such a way that, you know, you aren't slapping them in the face with it.